looks like it, but I've been around a while. When you get to be my age, certain things become clearer than ever. I know the American story. Again and again, I've seen the contest between competing forces and the battle for the soul of our nation, between those who want to pull America back to the past and those who want to move America into the future. My lifetime has taught me to embrace freedom and democracy, a future based on core values that have defined America: honesty, decency, dignity, equality, to respect everyone, to give everyone a fair shot, to give hate no safe harbor. Now, other people my age see it differently. The American story of resentment, revenge, and retribution, that's not me. I was born amid World War II, when America stood for the freedom of the world. I grew up in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and Claymont, Delaware, among working-class people who built this country. I watched in horror as two of my heroes, like many of you did, Dr. King and Bobby Kennedy, were assassinated. And their legacies inspired me to pursue a career in service. I left the law firm and became a public defender because my city of Wilmington was the only city in America occupied by the National Guard after Dr. King was assassinated because of the riots. And I became a county councilman almost by accident. I got elected to the United States Senate when I had no intention of running at age 29. Then vice president of our first black president. Now president to the first women vice president. In my career, I've been told I was too young. By the way, they didn't let me on ascended elevators for votes sometimes. Not a joke. And I've been told I'm too old. Whether young or old, I've always known what endures. I've known our North Star. The very idea of America is that we're all created equal and deserves to be treated equally throughout our lives. We've never fully lived up to that idea, but we've never walked away from it either. And I won't walk away from it now.
That's right, folks. President Joe Biden delivered a very defiant argument for a second term in his State of the Union speech, completely tearing into Donald Trump for fomenting resentment, rage, and retribution, and for jeopardizing freedom at home and abroad. He spent the entire speech really just firing shots at Trump, calling him my predecessor. He refused to call Trump by his name. He said he who won't be named, or my predecessor. Yes. He basically called out Trump from what the Associated Press says right here 13 times. 13 times. He yelled pretty much the whole speech. He's heard all of us talk about how old he is and how infirmed and feeble he is. And he's made sure that he came out yelling like he was DMX at this speech. Like, this man, where my dogs at? You know what I'm saying? This man went out of his way to make sure that you guys did not walk away from that speech thinking he was too old. Whatever they shot him up with or gave him in the back before that, it worked. It definitely worked. Because this is probably the best moment of his presidency, I would say, so far in terms of presenting himself as a viable candidate and not somebody who is declining, which obviously he is. He definitely was scrappy. I think that's the term to use. He was scrappy. He was defiant. Very desperate to break away from these notions of his him being enfeebled, or as the report that came out about him that chose where they chose not to charge him. They said he was a well-meaning but forgetful old man. What do you say? What they say? A forgetful and something old man. Yeah, they really laid into him when they decided not to charge him with in the documents, the loose documents case. He went on for 68 minutes. 68 minutes is a long time. And he basically fought with the Republicans, Marjorie Taylor Greene. He called, you know, she tried to goad him into something, and he fired right back at her. In this clip right here, let me see. Here we go.
I'm told my predecessor called members of Congress in the Senate to demand they block the bill. He feels political win. He viewed it as it'll be a political win for me and a political loser for him. It's not about him. It's not about me. I'd be a winner. Not really. Lincoln Riley, an innocent young woman who was killed by an illegal. That's right. But how many of the thousands of people being killed by illegals? To her parents, I say, my heart goes out to you, having lost children myself. I understand.
Right, so that was actually Joe Biden responding to Marjorie Taylor Greene, who started yelling at him about Lincoln Riley. Now, Lincoln Riley is this young white woman, who was killed by an illegal alien when she went out jogging. And so the Republicans have used her death to sort of beat Joe Biden and the Democrats over the head with about immigration. And so, you know, Joe Biden took that opportunity that you heard Marjorie Taylor Greene and the Republicans yelling at him to sort of spin that on them and say, hey, we had a deal, but you guys, Donald Trump just doesn't want to help me out. So if he, if you guys really wanted to do something, you guys would have supported the bill that even a lot of Republicans said was a good deal. So that was basically a winning point for Joe Biden, at least against the Republicans. Personally, one thing that was strange to me is that Joe Biden actually used the term illegal alien. He used the term illegal alien. When is the last time you heard an American president say illegal alien? I guess maybe Trump did. I don't know. I'd have to. But you know Obama didn't say illegal alien. I seriously doubt that as well. The Democrats have ended up in a position that a lot of us told you guys they were going to end up in, where immigration was going to be the thing that starts to beat them, that people beat them over the head with, that the Republicans would try to use to bludgeon them with. But ultimately, I think that Joe Biden sidestepped this pretty well. Let's see what else he talked about in the speech.
This war has taken a greater toll on innocent civilians than all previous wars in Gaza combined. More than 30,000 Palestinians have been killed, most of whom are not Hamas. Thousands and thousands of innocents, women and children, girls and boys, also orphaned. Nearly 2 million more Palestinians under bombardment or displacement. Homes destroyed, neighborhoods in rubble, cities in ruin, families without food, water, medicine. It's heartbreaking. The United States has been leading international efforts to get more humanitarian assistance to Gaza. Tonight, I'm directing the U.S. military to lead an emergency mission to establish a temporary pier in the Mediterranean on the coast of Gaza that can receive large shipments carrying food, water, medicine, and temporary shelters. No U.S. boots will be on the ground A temporary pier will enable a massive increase in the amount of humanitarian assistance getting into Gaza every day. And Israel must do its part. Israel must allow more aid into Gaza to ensure humanitarian workers aren't caught in the crossfire. And they're announcing they're going to have a crossing in northern Gaza. To the leadership of Israel, I say this. Humanitarian assistance cannot be a secondary consideration or a bargaining chip. Protecting and saving innocent lives has to be a priority. As we look to the future, the only real solution to the situation is a two-state solution over time.
Right. So that's Joe Biden right there talking. This is really the thing that he tried to hide in his speech, because Gaza, particularly with the base, particularly with young people and minorities, Gaza, what's going on, aiding and abetting a genocide, is killing Biden with young people and minorities. He knows that. He really didn't want to talk about this. He actually took a alternate route to he took an alternate route there, because he was afraid that if he went the normal way, that he'd be confronted by protesters. And so they snuck him in the back door. They had to sneak Joe Biden in the back door so that he would not be descended upon by protesters. That's how serious this is. Now, he talked about building some port. That port is going to cost tens of billions of dollars. Tens of billions of dollars. When all he has to do is tell Israel to knock it off, or I'll stop sending you funding and missiles and all that other stuff. But this just goes to show you how much over a barrel Israel has all of our politicians. Joe Biden is literally, or at least in theory, the most powerful man in the world. Israel could not be doing what they're doing to the Palestinians and starving them to death and not allowing them food if he just said, hey, cut it off or we'll cut you off. That's all he got to say. Cut it off, we'll cut you off. But he won't do that. This man talking about building a whole other port worth billions of that the American public are going to have to spend billions on to circumvent the people that we are funding. How are you going to be funding somebody who's telling you to go to hell and they're going to do what they want? But again, look at the power that Israel has over all of our politicians. Don't matter if they're black, if they're white, if they're Republicans, if they're Democrats. All three of the major candidates, Joe Biden, Donald Trump, and Robert F. Kennedy Jr., who's polling almost as good as Trump and Biden, though the corporate liberal media won't acknowledge that. They're all hardcore Zionists who support the genocide that is going on. But only Joe Biden is pretending that he doesn't support the genocide that's going on. But it's obvious he does, because he could stop it tomorrow if he wanted to. So I thought, I mean, he knows that this is a losing topic for him. So he sort of couched this in the speech.
Starting next year, the same law caps total prescription drug costs for seniors on Medicare at $2,000 a year. Even for expensive cancer drugs, it costs $10,000, $12,000, $15,000. Now, I want to cap prescription drug costs at $2,000 a year for everyone. Yeah. Folks, I'm going to get in trouble for saying that, but if you want to get an Air Force One and fly to Toronto, Berlin, Moscow, I mean, excuse me, and even Moscow, probably. And bring your prescription with you, and I promise you I'll get it for you for 40% the cost you're paying now. Same company, same drug, same place. Folks, the Affordable Care Act, the old Obamacare, is still a very big deal. Over 100 million of you can no longer be denied health insurance because of pre-existing condition. But my predecessor and many in this chamber want to take this prescription drug away by repealing the Affordable Care Act. I'm not going to let that happen. We stopped you 50 times before and we'll stop you again. In fact, I'm not only protecting it, I'm expanding it. The enacted tax credits of $800 per person per year reduce health care costs for millions of working families. That tax credit expires next year. I want to make that savings permanent.
Okay, so that's Joe Biden talking about how he's fighting to fighting to change the pricing on prescription drugs, particularly for older people, people over 65. To me, a lot of this rings hollow to me because he does not support universal health care. You know, a lot of this just turns out to be a Band-Aid on a gunshot wound. Why would anybody have to pay $2,000 a year in the richest country in the history of the world, where we have billions of dollars to send money to Israel and Ukraine and, you know, all have 900 military bases around the world? Why would anybody be spending $2,000 a year on medicine? He says that like it's a flex. You know, it's not a flex. I'm sorry. Nobody should be paying that much for prescription drugs in the richest country in history if you have money to essentially colonize the whole planet and fund massacres and genocides and foment wars across the planet with the military-industrial complex. It makes zero sense that America is the only rich country, the only first world country that does not have, that does not guarantee health care for its people. That is disgusting. Obamacare started off as Romney Care because it was Mitt Romney, the Republicans from Massachusetts plan, and Obama stole it. The woman who wrote the bill went to go work for Johnson & Johnson afterwards. So that tells you, again, the real purpose of Obamacare. The day that it passed, the stock prices of all the health insurance companies went way up the day that Obamacare passed. So once again, it was a giveaway to corporate interest, just like everything else Barack Obama did. And Joe Biden is talking about it like it's the greatest thing in the history of the world. Now, if you want to argue it's better than what we had, fine. But it's like saying, you know, well, I've got syphilis now. That's better than having cancer. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? It's like, okay, all right. But no, Joe Biden was not finished. Let's see what he got into it with the Republicans again about immigration.
I will not demonize immigrants, saying they are poison in the blood of our country. I will not separate families. I will not ban people because of their faith. Unlike my predecessor, on my first day in office, I introduced a comprehensive bill to fix our immigration system. Take a look at it, as all these and more. Secure the border, provide a pathway to citizenship for dreamers, and so much more. But unlike my predecessor, I know who we are as Americans. We're the only nation in the world with a heart and soul that draws from old and new. Home to Native Americans and ancestors have been here for thousands of years. home to people of every place, from every place on earth. They came freely. Some came in chains. Some came when famine struck, like my ancestral family in Ireland. Some to flee persecution, to chase dreams that are impossible anywhere but here in America. That's America. And we all come from somewhere, but we're all Americans. Look, folks, we have a simple choice. We can fight about fixing the border, or we can fix it.
So that's him talking about immigration. Like, the Democrats have a weird relationship with immigration, as we talk about on this show very often. Historically, the left in this country were the ones who fought against illegal immigration. We've talked about A. Philip Randolph, a socialist, the greatest black labor leader in this country's history, who did not think that anybody should be allowed to immigrate into the country until black people were made whole. Okay, socialist. You look at people like Cesar Chavez. I played the clip on this show many times where Cesar Chavez is saying it's not our job to import Mexico's poverty. He spent most of his career fighting against illegal immigration. And even going down to the Mexican border and physically, him and his cousin Manuel used to go down to the border and physically throw illegal immigrants back across the border. You know. And Ralph Abernathy, Martin Luther King's right-hand man, his best friend, he used to go down there with Cesar Chavez, and they would protest illegal immigration and demand. They used to call ICE on people. Cesar Chavez was calling ICE on people until the early 80s, when he sort of moderated his stance on immigration and became a little bit less of a restrictionist as he got older. But for most of his career, he was ruthlessly anti-illegal immigration. And so was Ralph Abernathy. Coretta Scott King, we talked about it on this show. Coretta Scott King wrote the Republican, Orrin Hatch, in the early 90s and begged him to do something about illegal immigration because it was hurting black men's opportunities and ability to get jobs. You know, I say this to give context. Look at Bill Clinton in the 90s talk about illegal immigration. He sounds like Trump. Listen to Bill Clinton's State of the Union address, and I want to say 96, I want to say. He sounds just like Trump talking about illegal immigration. Read Obama's book, where Obama talks about illegal immigration and how it does not benefit the working classes. Bernie Sanders called open borders a Koch brothers, the Republican donors, the big money Republican donors. That's the left for most of the 20th and early 21st century. Illegal immigration is bad for workers. Illegal immigration is bad for the poor. It's a little bad for the working classes. Now, since the sort of weird academic wing of the liberals have taken control of the Democratic Party, they've had to sort of moderate a lot of this because they believe in this sort of great replacement theory that, you know, they simultaneously vilify Tucker Carlson and right-wingers for talking about the great replacement theory. But liberals themselves have been saying for decades now that they are waiting for America to be majority brown to actually enact a lot of the policies that they want to enact, because they can't do it because America's too white and racist. You know? And what I always tell people is, look, you say that, but look at Latin America. We've talked about Latin America on this show. Latin America is one of the most racist places on planet Earth. There are very few places in the world more racist than Latin America. Look at how black people are treated in Ecuador, in Mexico, in Brazil, Dominican Republic. Look at how Dominicans look at Haitians because they're black. Blacker than them, should I say. Because Dominicans are black too, but they'll be black as night and talk about, you know, I know black, Poppy. Me no black, Poppy. Or they'll be like Sammy Sosa bleaching their skin or something. So these people have no love for black people. They don't have any love for black people in their own countries. They're definitely not going to have love for black Americans. and often don't. You know, go ask some of the Mexicans in L.A. how they feel about black people. In East L.A., they ran a lot of black, the whatever black families they were, they firebombed their homes and ran them out. Now, I'm not saying all Hispanics are racist. Don't get, I mean, you got people like Eve and Juan, who just preceded me on the radio, who are cool as hell, okay? I mean, Eve is blacker than a lot of people I know. She's blacker than a lot of the black people I know, okay? Keep it 100. She keeps it real, you know? But that doesn't mean that there's not anti-blackness in Latin communities, just like there is in Americans' communities. So just saying we're waiting for America to become more full with more Hispanics and Asians, and then will America stop being racist? You don't understand how racism works. I'm sorry. You don't understand how white supremacy works. Go to Brazil. Brazil is one of the most diverse countries in the world. Go ask black people how they're treated in Brazil. They had a black beauty queen in Brazil. They had a black woman who won like the carnival queen or whatever. And you know, they harassed this woman. They harassed the TV station that they had the contest at. They tried to, like, everybody involved is like, how dare you have a black woman be the queen of the carnival? Like, good Lord, like, as if Brazil isn't a super duper black country. It's got more black people than America does, at about half the size. So no, America being a majority non-white country is not going to save us as black people. It's not going to make us any less racist. If anything, it might make us more racist. Because those white Cubans in Florida, like Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio, and all those white Mexicans in Texas, they don't have the type of white guilt that a lot of white liberals in this country have. That, by their stance, we weren't here. We're immigrants. We weren't here. We're not responsible for any of that. We don't care about any of it. Our ancestors aren't the ones who owned slaves in this country. Now, our ancestors may have owned slaves in our country, but not in this one. So, no, I don't think that just merely importing a bunch of immigrants here is going to benefit. But we actually saw, we saw from what the Democrats used to be, too. I played the clip a few weeks ago of Dick Durbin, who was the senator in Illinois along with Obama, who's been a senator in Illinois as long as I can remember. Since I was a kid, Dick Durbin's been around. And he actually said that we need illegal immigrants and we need this massive influx of immigrants to make up our military. Because Americans are refusing to join. And they kicked out a lot of Americans with those vaccine mandates that look really dumb in retrospect now. Does not look good in retrospect, folks. But Biden was not done yet. He still went on and on.
Look. It's a decision to overturn Roe v. Wade. The Supreme Court majority wrote the following, and with all due respect, justices, women are not without electoral power. Electoral or political power. You're about to realize just how much you were right about that. Clearly. clearly. Those bragging about overturning Roe v. Wade have no clue about the power of women. But they found out when reproductive freedom was on the ballot, we won in 2022 and 2020, and we'll win again in 2024. If you, the American people, send me a Congress that supports the right to choose, I promise you, I'll restore Roe v. Wade as the law of the land again.
Oh. Now, what he doesn't tell you is that he could have codified Roe v. Wade into law when he got in office. And he had the House, the Senate, and the White House. The Democrats could have codified Roe v. Wade under Joe Biden. They could have codified Roe v. Wade over Barack Obama. Barack Obama actually said it would be the first thing he did when he got in office. He actually said that. He really did. And then as soon as he got in the office, he went back on that promise.
As you were talking about earlier, the recent Bush Supreme Court's decisions really took away critically important decisions from women and put them in the hands of politicians. And as a result of this, we're expecting and have already seen so much anti-choice legislation at the state level. What would you do at the federal level, not only to ensure access to abortion, but to make sure that the judicial nominees that you will inevitably be able to pick are true to the core tenets of Roe v. Wade?
Well, the first thing I do as president is sign the Freedom of Choice Act. That's the first thing that I do.
And he was lying, because he's, and then when they asked him about it, he said, oh, it's not that important. Obama could have codified Roe v. Wade in the law. Bill Clinton could have done it before the Republicans retook the House in 94. Jimmy Carter could have done it. Here's the uncut dope, folks. The Republicans and the Democrats, both of them like the status quo as it was of Roe v. Wade. The mainstream, the establishment wing of the Democrats and Republicans, both liked the status quo of Roe v. Wade. They both wanted to keep it where it was. The Democrats liked having abortion in peril, because if abortion's in peril, then they can raise lots of money so that, oh, you got to elect the Democrats, you got to give us all your money, because, you know, we're trying to keep abortion legal. The Republicans liked having abortion legal as well. The mainstream, the Mitch McConnell, the mainstream Republicans liked having Roe v. Wade too, because then they could say, look, you got to give us more money so that we can overturn Roe v. Wade. Now, where it went wrong for everybody is that Donald Trump is a chaos agent. That's what he is. He's a pure chaos agent. And so Donald Trump just said, Donald Trump is like the guy who, goes too hard. He went too hard. He actually put the people on the Supreme Court that actually would overturn Roe v. Wade, instead of just talk about, you know, overturning Roe v. Wade like the Republicans historically have. And so the Republicans, that's why if you look at a lot of the Republicans were not happy when Roe v. Wade were overturned. A lot of them sort of played it down. They knew that it was a losing issue for them. They just liked using it as an issue. They just liked telling people that they were against abortion. They didn't actually want it to come down. Trump didn't care one way or the other. You know, as like I said, as the chaos agent he is, he just threw, you know, a spinner in the whole works and just messed up the whole game for the Democrats and the Republicans. Now, the Democrats have won every election cycle since Roe v. Wade were overturned. It's why I personally believe that the Democrats will win again. I think Joe Biden will win again. I do believe that. I'm not going to vote for him. I'm voting third party like I always do. But I do think that you know, I'm sorry, Ms. McCready, but white women, abortion is their issue. And white women are the biggest voting group bloc in America. We don't talk about that a lot, but they are. They're the biggest voting bloc in the country. And as the biggest voting bloc in the country, I believe they will sway the election. People are talking about the genocide in Gaza. White women don't care as much about Palestinians as they care about being able to kill fetuses. Okay? I mean, I know that's very crude the way to put it, but I'm just being real with you here. Like, the right to get rid of a fetus is way more important to them than saving some Palestinians. It's way more important than ending the mass incarceration of black people or universal health care or any poverty, anything else. The Democrats are run by a sort of bougie, elite, educated, white feminist wing. That's who the most powerful people in the Pelosi wing, the Hillary Clinton wing, those people care about abortion. And I believe that ultimately that will carry the day. That's why the Democrats can't wait to put abortion front and center, because they know it is the winning issue for them. And the Republicans screwed up by overturning Roe v. Wade. Here's him talking about Trump with Ukraine.
Overseas, Putin of Russia is on the march, invading Ukraine and sowing chaos throughout Europe and beyond. If anybody in this room thinks Putin will stop at Ukraine, I assure you he will not. But Ukraine can stop Putin. Ukraine can stop Putin if we stand with Ukraine and provide the weapons that needs to defend itself. Now my predecessor, a former Republican president, tells Putin, quote, do whatever the hell you want. That's a quote. A former president actually said that, bowing down to a Russian leader. I think it's outrageous, it's dangerous, and it's unacceptable. My message to President Putin, who I've known for a long time, is simple. We will not walk away. We will not bow down. I will not bow down. In a literal sense, history is watching. History is watching.
Yep, so that's Joe Biden sounding just like Ronald Reagan in 1988 or something. I remember when being pro-war and flexing your muscles used to be a right-wing Republican thing. Now it's who the liberals are. It's who liberals have embraced Cold War rhetoric. They've embraced the sort of idea of endless wars. We talked about how on this show how Joe Biden purposely antagonized Vladimir Putin and NATO. They both are antagonizing NATO. Vladimir Putin, because they wanted this conflict, and we are all paying a lot at the pump and for groceries than we were before this, because they were antagonizing Vladimir Putin. Vladimir Putin told them 15 years ago, stop expanding NATO. I can't let you guys encircle me here. He told them. I can't let you guys, encircle me here. And they kept doing it. And then he said to Jens Stoltenberg from NATO, 3 years ago, he said, look, if you guys keep messing around in Ukraine, I'm going to have to invade Ukraine. Please stop expanding NATO. And they said, oh, go to hell. Okay, well, F around and find out. But this is not this idea that Vladimir Putin is just some madman who just invaded a country for no reason is nonsense. He told Bill Clinton, he told George W. Bush, he told Barack Obama, he told everybody, A, I will do what it takes to keep Russia safe, and you guys circling us is not going to keep us safe. I'm sorry. And then after 20 years of them not listening to him, then he finally invaded Ukraine, including after they overthrew Ukraine's democratically elected government with its president, Viktor Yanukovych, and replaced him with a U.S. NATO puppet stooge and started killing all the Russian-speaking people in the Donbass region. But, you know, finally, after all this time, I think the American people are finally tired of funding the war in Ukraine, especially with Israel doing what it's doing. So it looks like that might be a losing issue for Biden and the Democrats. And finally, the Republicans had a rebuttal. I know I'm going on for a while, but this is pretty important, The Republicans had a rebuttal. This is Senator Katie Britt. This is what she had to say. Listen to her.
Like so many families across America, my husband Wesley and I just watched President Biden's State of the Union address from our living room. And what we saw was the performance of a permanent politician who has actually been in office for longer than I've been alive. Our country can do better. And you don't have to look any further than the crisis at our southern border to see it. President Biden inherited the most secure border of all time. But minutes after taking office, he suspended all deportations, he halted construction of the border wall, and he announced a plan to give amnesty to millions. We know that President Biden didn't just create this border crisis. He invited it with 94 executive actions in his first 100 days. Just think about Lake and Riley. In my neighboring state of Georgia, this beautiful 22-year-old nursing student went out on a jog one morning, but she never got the opportunity to return home. She was brutally murdered by one of the millions of illegal border crossers President Biden chose to release into our homeland. The American people are scraping by while President Biden proudly proclaims that Bidenomics is working. Goodness, y'all, bless his heart, we know better. We've become a nation in retreat, and the enemies of freedom, they see an opportunity. Putin's brutal aggression in Europe has put our allies on the brink. Iran's terrorist proxies have slaughtered Israeli Jews and American citizens. They've targeted commercial shipping, and they've attacked our troops nearly 200 times since October, killing 3 U.S. soldiers and 2 Navy SEALs. China is buying up our farmland, spying on our military installations, and spreading propaganda through the likes of TikTok. You see, the CCP knows that if it conquers the minds of our next generation, it conquers America. Right now, our commander-in-chief is not in command. The free world deserves better than a dithering and diminished leader. We want families to grow. It's why we strongly support continued nationwide access to in vitro fertilization. We want to help loving moms and dads bring precious life into this world.
Yeah, that was bizarre. I'm not going to lie. That was absolutely bizarre. I don't know who Katie Britt, well, I know who she is. She's a senator, but she should never do this again. I mean, she sounds like a B-list soap opera actress or something, trying to give that rebuttal to the State of the Union. Ultimately, both parties at this point are in shambles. It's never been a better time to vote third party and to throw the shackles off, step off the plantation, the corporate liberal, corporate conservative plantation, and have some integrity and honor and get away from these degenerates like Joe Biden and Donald Trump. All right, folks, I got to go to a break. I went on for 50 minutes, and I don't want Dr. Williams to come in with the 2x4, so we're going to have to pay some bills. When we get back, we're going to talk about obesity. Yes, obesity. We'll be right back after these.